Great, okay, I think we should go ahead and get started. I know some people will join us as we go through the introduction here. Good afternoon, or rather, I think good afternoon, good morning, or good evening. This presentation has people attending from Asia, South America, Europe, and North America, including Canada and Mexico. So we're really thrilled to have everybody here. I want to welcome you to our next presentation in our series of alumni webcasts. LGO and SDM provide these webcasts as continuing education opportunities for the benefit of our alumni, our industry partners, and the greater LGO and SDM community. We hold these presentations approximately once a month. First, a housekeeping item, if you haven't heard me before, it's much better quality if everyone would mute your phones, and you can do that by pressing *6. Later, if you do want to ask an audio question, you can press #6 to unmute your phone. So press *6 now to mute your phone. Okay, great. Thank you. In a moment, Professor Stephen Effringer will start his presentation. There will be time for questions and answers at the end of the presentation. If you have a clarifying question during the presentation, you can use the chat function on the right-hand side of your screen to ask Steve any questions. When the question and answer period begins, you can either ask by chat or by telephone. Since Steve is so well known to the LGO and SDM communities, I think we'll forego reading his bio. I did want to mention, if you haven't already heard, that Steve was just named the Sloan co-director for the SDM program, and so we're really happy to welcome Steve back as our co-director. Thanks a lot. So welcome, Steve.
Thank you. So I'll get started here. So it's great to see so many of our alumni names and many of my former students. My topic today is design for environment, and so this is a topic related directly to product design and development, and that's a class that many of you took from me, product design and development, or it's also a textbook that many of you know that I wrote. When you took the PDD class, we may or may not have discussed this topic of DFE, design for environment, and what I'm going to do today is to tell you where I think we are today on that topic. The reason the topic was not in the textbook is I didn't feel that there was an established best practice method, but today my opinion on that has changed. So I've actually written with Michael Bereswil, who's actually on the line from Switzerland today. I've written with Michael a new chapter for the textbook that will be in the next edition. So this is kind of a preview of that. It will be out in about a year. We're beta testing it now, and this is actually part of the beta test. I'll be presenting some of the concepts, the key ideas in the chapter. So what I'd like to talk about is what some people call green design or design for environment, or more precisely design, product design for environmental sustainability. I'll start with some examples of what does this mean or what does it not mean, so how do we think about that. I'll define DFE, what do I mean by it, and then I'll tell you how I think we can move toward true sustainability, which is, of course, a goal that's going to take a long, long, long time. But we have to move toward it now, so we have to be moving in that direction. So how do we think carefully about this in the development process to move in that direction? Then I'll explain a bit of the process of DFE that we've written in the chapter, and then and show you an application of it from Herman Miller, and then I'll wrap up, and we'll take some questions. So let's see if my pointer control is working here. Okay, good. So let me start with a couple of examples. So this first example is from Patagonia, so they're a garment manufacturer. And for a couple of decades now, they've been using some post-consumer recycled plastic in making the fleece in some of their products. So that's an interesting approach to DFE, and this is essentially using recycled materials. It's an important element of it. So that's one example that we can think about and kind of ground ourselves with that. A second example comes from Europe, so from Stock. This is called the Trip Trap chair. And the approach here is this is a chair that lasts not only as a high chair, it's useful not only as a high chair when the child is very young, but it could last through adulthood. So that the chair has an effective lifetime. In fact, many people have these around their kitchen tables in Norway, for example, even for adults. So single chair that outlives the high chair use. also happens to be made with some natural and recyclable materials. So that's a second example of maybe some good DFE thinking. Third example from Dunlop, which in the UK makes what's called the Wellies, the Wellington boots. Now these are made from, well, three materials, polyurethane, PVC, and rubber. PVC is not a great material to be using these days, has some toxicity concerns. Nevertheless, they have taken what's out there, millions of used boots, and said, you know, we could recycle those into new boots. And so, well, better to recycle than to simply dispose of all that PVC. So they actually take back used boots from customers, and they can regrind them and make them into some new boots. So there's a third example. Let me show you a fourth, and then I'll try to reflect on this. So these are bags made by Freytag in Switzerland, and they actually used materials from truck tarps that cover the soft-sided trucks that drive all around Europe, inner tubes from automobiles or trucks usually, and seatbelts from automobiles when they're dismantled at the junkyard. And they turn them into bags that consumers have, bike bags, messenger bags, that shoulder bags, that sort of thing. So here's reuse of materials. As I reflect on these four examples, Patagonia, Wellington, Stock, and Freytag, I wonder, how do we actually know? How do we know that these are better? How do we know that we've reduced the environmental impact by doing this instead of something else? How do we know it's not just green marketing? You know, it's better on one narrow dimension, and we tell you all about that, you know, using bottles instead of oil or whatever. But how do you know it's not worse on 10 other dimensions, or worse overall? So how do you know, and how do you make some good decisions about this? So it's useful to think about, well, what is the range of environmental impact, and how do we sum them up? How do we add them up in some way? First of all, it's useful to recognize that's incredibly hard to do. You know, how do we decide whether it's worse to have 2 tons of CO2, which contributes to global warming, or, you know, I don't know, 100 pounds of a certain kind of solid waste that may contribute to water pollution and so on? How do you know? It's actually very hard, probably one would say impossible, to precisely sum up those different dimensions of environmental impact. So this is an inherently very hard problem. So how do we think about that? Well, one way is to ask, you know, whose problem is it and how are we going to solve it? And so you could think of this as it's a legacy problem. You know, we, our generation, we didn't create this. This is just something we've inherited as this is how our industrial world, our industrial processes work. Okay, that's true. Is it a material problem? I mean, if we just focus on just the materials, are we going to be able to solve this? Can we actually make progress, or is it hopeless? And I'd like, so my answer here is yes, this is a legacy problem, it is a materials problem, and we're going to think about it that way. But it's a solvable problem, and we can think about it in better ways. So how do we do that? So DFE, Design for Environment, or Green Design, and so on, this is a way to start to think about this. And I've created a way of thinking about this that's connected really strongly to the product development process. So that's what we're going to talk a little bit about today. I want to start with a couple of perspectives on this, the life cycle perspective. And I'm sure you're all familiar with the concept of product life cycles. I'm going to give you maybe a twist on that helps you think about materials life cycles, which I think is core to that. And I'd like to give credit for helping us to think about this to William McDonough, who's a pretty famous architect today, and Michael Braungart, who's actually a material chemist who works with McDonough. And they wrote this book just a few years ago. It came out 2002 called Cradle to Cradle. And the key idea of Cradle to Cradle, I've got on the next slide, the key idea is we need to think really carefully about the materials, about using renewable materials, using recyclable materials, and using only renewable and recyclable materials. And that's how we're going to get to sustainability. So let me give you a summary of the book in one picture. And then we'll use that to think about the PD process. So you're probably familiar with what's called product lifecycle, and that's actually the one on the right, the blue one. So you think about the materials we use, we produce products, we distribute products, we use the products, and then we recover or dispose whatever those materials or recycle, and all the red arrows are the choices you have, you know, in recovery. So think of that not as a bad process. Think of that as a necessary process. You know, we're only going to have industrial products if we run that cycle. And this cycle coexists with another necessary and good process, and that's the natural biological life cycle, where materials get deposited into the earth, they decay, and then they create new resources through that decay process. We extract those materials and we use them. Now, of course, plants do that. You know, when I put compost in my bin, it gets deposited into the soil and it gets made into new garden materials for my vegetables and so on. So I mean, that cycle happens, and it's a good one. So think of both of these as good cycles. And so what's the problem? Where's the bad part? Well, let me now embed that those cycles into the bigger picture. So the bigger picture is that these cycles need energy to run. And, of course, we have renewable energy, which essentially all comes from the sun. I mean, there's a little bit of energy from, say, the Earth's decay, but for the most part, you know, wind energy is based on solar activity, right? And wave energy and, of course, solar energy and so on. So we have renewable energy. Even plant energy comes off from the sun. So there's a source of renewable energy, and as you probably know, we have plenty of it. We really do. And then, of course, there are non-renewable sources of energy that we have to stop using, or stop using faster than the Earth creates them, which is pretty darn slow. And then, of course, the other problem with these cycles is they could create toxins, things that will poison the environment, things that won't naturally degrade into new good materials we can reuse, things that are environmental or human toxins. And so we could think about what's in the box, the two life cycles, as good, and we need to run them. And the bad part is we need to stop using non-renewable resources and stop creating toxins that poison the Earth. So that the two good cycles can run essentially forever. So that's the goal of sustainability, and as everyone's aware, we are nowhere near this. You know, we are so far from this sustainable goal that it's pretty depressing. But we've got to make progress. So how do we use this thinking to make progress? Well, to summarize, there's sustainability would mean considering this system as a closed system, and we have good cycles, and they're fine. We have only one source of renewable energy, and that's the sun, and it creates many ways to extract renewable energy. But and then we've got to just balance the resources, you know, and only use resources that can work in those cycles, and avoid things that disable those cycles, right? The toxic waste and so on. So these conditions for sustainability have been put out 15, 20 years ago. We're now just thinking about, I think we're starting to create a way to think about how do we bring that into a PD process, into a product development process. So that's where I've been working on that lately. And so some of you know the textbook. I've used maybe an earlier version. The current is the fourth edition, and I'm working on the fifth edition right now, and it will have a new chapter called Design for Environment. The draft chapter we're using right now and taught it in our class this month at MIT in our product design class, and it's being beta tested elsewhere. So the new chapter on DSE, I'd be happy to send it to some of you if you're interested. Let me just highlight a couple things that are in there. So first of all, there's the product development process that you all know. That's the one that's in the arrows at the top. And then the question is, where do we put DSE in there? And is it something that happens right at the end when we're thinking about, oh, how good or bad is this product? And then, of course, as you know, it's very hard to change. So we've created a process that starts at the beginning with goal setting and saying, well, what are we going to do? Of course, we're not going to get to sustainability, but let's move somewhere in that direction. And then how? Are we going to do it by changing our materials or changing our recycling or changing our take-back or what? So we make some goals. And then I'm a big fan of having guidelines that are really usable. So we'll talk about DFE guidelines and specific material guidelines. And then later in the process, we can assess the impact and maybe refine the designs, and hopefully we've made good progress. And then I'm also a fan of continuous improvement. So as you may recall, every chapter, every process ends with an improvement process. Okay. So that process has been laid out, and it'll now be in the new chapter. This is a bit more detail on it. So in product planning, we set an agenda, find the right team, and so forth, and set some goals. In concept development, there's specific things we do about choosing the right guidelines that we're going to apply. We apply them as we're creating the initial designs and decompositions and system level design. And then through detailed design, we assess how did we do and modify the materials or the connections or the way the product is produced and so forth. So that's the process. Let me just highlight a couple of elements of the process, and then I'll show you an example. So the elements of the process, one I'd like to highlight is pretty early on, you can have a pretty good idea of where in the product life cycle, materials, production, distribution, use, recovery, which of those phases of the product life cycle creates the environmental impact. Now, most products create environmental impact in all of those, but some are very little in use, and some are a lot in use, and some are a lot in materials and so forth, in distribution and so forth. Turns out you could do a highly detailed, what's called LCA, life cycle assessment, to help you to run this analysis, and it would give you this impact in many dimensions and all the different types of pollutants and so forth. Usually that's really hard to do, and what I've found is you can actually take a pretty good stab at that just based on your understanding and a little simple analysis. And so even just in a qualitative way, you can say, you know what, we think that the impact of our product is primarily in the materials, or it's primarily in the usage and what's created effluents or whatever during different parts of the process. And based on that, you can choose which guidelines and where to focus in the PD process. So this, even in a qualitative way, is feasible to do right up front, and that's a useful guide. So that's one of the key elements. Another one is, well, what are the guidelines like? In the chapter, we've got a bunch of very specific guidelines, but just example of things you can think about in terms of DFE. Now, unfortunately, there's a lot of don't do things in the guidelines, but they're useful to think about. So, for example, don't combine materials that are incompatible in recycling. So if you combine two materials that are perfectly recyclable, you know, like wood and plastic, and you bond them together in such a way that they can't be separated feasibly, easily, economically, and so forth, then you've taken two recyclable things and made a non-recyclable hybrid. And so try to avoid that. And that may require different production processes and different ways of thinking, but that's just an example of one guideline. And you see a bunch of others, what might not be so obvious. Surface treatment, things like, and I'll show you an example from Herman Miller. You know, when you take a surface of something that is, say, recyclable, like aluminum or steel, and then you paint it with something that can't be removed, or when you recycle it, it gets melted or burnt off and creates toxics, that's not a great thing to do, because now you've taken something that's recyclable, you made it either less recyclable or creating bad materials and toxics when it's recycled. And so try to avoid things like that, and so forth. On the material side, it's pretty straightforward. You know, using recycled and recyclable industrial materials allows us to run through that industrial cycle over and over again. And so using more and more recycled and less virgin materials is important. When we use natural materials, and we can and should, you know, wool and leather and wood and so forth in products, let's make sure those can be separated and returned to the biological decay cycle. You know, so if you have, leather on the Nike shoes, let's make sure that the leather isn't, you know, treated with toxic tannins and so forth, such that when you put them back into the soil, it poisons the soil. Instead, let's use whatever inks and so forth that are natural materials and so forth. So it's a matter of just thinking about those. So there are guidelines. So I'm a fan of using guidelines to guide designers to make smart decisions. And we've found in the past with things such as design for manufacturing how powerful guidelines are. So even without detailed cost analysis, we can make huge progress on DFM with guidelines. And so that's what got us to thinking, you know, guidelines will probably help us a whole lot in DFE. Okay, so I'd like to share an example from Herman Miller. Herman Miller's company that many of you may know based on some of their furniture products, that they're a furniture manufacturer, an office furniture manufacturer. It's been around for almost 100 years, actually. And so they're sort of a high-end office furniture, I mean, well, mainstream, but pretty nice furniture. So, for example, the Aeron chair, which won all kinds of design awards in the mid-90s, not for its environmental considerations, but rather for its ergonomics. I don't think it's a particularly beautiful chair. Nevertheless, it was, I think I'm actually sitting in one right now. Yeah, I am. It won this for its ergonomics. I actually like it very much. It's my desk chair. Then 10 years later, they essentially redesigned that chair with environment in mind. And so the Mira chair has all the similar kind of ergonomics of a good task chair, and by that we mean a chair in which you would be comfortable sitting all day. Here I'm at my workstation, and you know, if you're going to sit there all day, you want to be able to adjust the recline, adjust the seating, adjust the arm pads, make it just right for you and your fit. That's the idea of a task chair. And so they redesigned the Aeron chair, or that functionality, in the Mira chair 10 years later with a company called Studio 7.5 in Berlin. I'll tell you a bit about them. Herman Miller actually uses all outside industrial designers, so they actually have none on their staff, and so they work with lots of designers around the world, including this one. So the Mira did a nice job. And then 5 years later, the same outside design firm, Studio 7.5, designed what's called a Setu chair, and this is just coming out this year, or it just came out last year, and they're ramping it up in production even still right now. The Setu is not a task chair. It's actually what's called a multi-purpose chair. So you notice there's a lot less mechanism in it. And that alone allowed them to reduce 20 pounds of weight. And that's 20 pounds of material that you don't have to, you know, recycle and use again and so forth. The interesting thing about the Setu chair is it's basically got no adjustments except for height. And so it's not a task chair, it's called a multi-purpose chair. But I don't know, you probably all had this experience. You go into a conference room and they've furnished the entire room with a nice big table and Aeron chairs all around the table. And every one of them is misadjusted. You know, one arm is higher than the other, or nobody knows how to set the decline or the height and so forth. It's not set for you because in a conference room, you get all kinds of people sitting for 1 hour. So a multi-purpose chair, they're trying to push more of this because it will probably solve a lot of problems out there, allows them to actually strip a lot of functionality out in adjustability, and actually reduce the weight, which is a huge benefit to reducing the environmental impact. So we actually used, as you recall in the textbook, perhaps if you remember it, each chapter has a solid industry example we use to illustrate the method. So we approached Herman Miller and asked, you know, could we talk about how you do DFE as an illustration of good DFE practice in using this method? And so we did that. And the first thing that we learned about Herman Miller is they started to think about this in the 1990s. It was actually early 90s that they started to think about hazardous waste and landfill. So you see on this slide, their goal for 2020 is to have zero landfill. They actually established that goal in 1990. And they started telling me about this, and I was thinking, well, hold on, I just want to hear about DFE. I don't want to hear about zero landfill from operations. They said, no, hold on a minute. The idea is that we couldn't achieve a lot of progress on DFE for products until we straightened out our operations. And they explained it as follows. They said, in 1990, we looked around at this factory operation. I was sitting in their this factory makes, you know, 15,000 chairs a day, and it's got 3,000 people who work there, and they've got an office and everything, and marketing staff and so forth, and engineering. They said, you know how much landfill comes out of this operation every day? Just think about it. All the trucks coming in with materials and packaging and so forth, and all the cafeteria operations and all the office operations. Said it's just tons, right? I mean, there's just dumpsters and trucks taking stuff out of here every day. We set a goal to eliminate that, and back in like 1991. And after a while, we realized that there's only so much you can do by being really lean and waste reduction and careful, because some of it's just built into your process. And so we were looking at a table, a work surface. He said, this is a wood panel with a laminate covering. And both of those, the plastic laminate and the wood, are recyclable, as I was saying earlier. But think about this. If they then cut away the edge to make the round in the corner, now you've got some scrap. And that factory scrap can't be recycled because it's already got the plastic bounded to the wood. He said, if we change our process, we'll reduce the scrap that comes out of our factory, the scrap that can't be recycled and has to go into landfill. And we had to change the product design and change the processes. So that was a pretty interesting perspective. So, by the way, then I asked, so how are you doing on this, zero landfill goal? They said, oh, this entire operation, this whole factory, this entire place, 20 pounds a month is all that goes into landfill out of the entire place. And I looked in the corner of the conference room, and sure enough, there's a bin for recyclable plastic, there's a bin for recyclable metals, there's a bin for recyclable paper, there's a bin for compostables, there's a bin for combustibles, and so on. And then they take the compost that they're creating and the gas that's coming off of that, and they burn that for electrical energy. So they've been able to have... As you can think today, their goal is not just zero landfill, it's zero a lot of things. And so they're actually, the factory now is using 100% green electrical energy. So they're using wind power, they're using solar power, they're using the gases off the landfill composting to burn that for generations and so forth. So this is a company that's taking it seriously. Now let me just tell you a little bit more about the SETSU chair. One of the key elements of this chair is it's a very comfortable chair that actually reclines and everything, even though they've dramatically minimized the mechanism. So take a look at that spine. So what's called, I don't have to point to it, but it's obvious that what's called the spine. There's two rails, an inner and outer rail, that form the support for the back and the base of the chair. And they're connected by this little webbing. And that's actually all one piece, that spine. And it's recyclable, even though it's made of multiple materials. And they went around and around all kinds of iterations to figure out how are they going to make something as, complex and clever as that. So it's a co-molded polypropylene. So there's two polypropylene materials. The outer one is a glass-filled polypropylene polymer, so it's nylon and glass. Polypropylene and a glass-filled, fiberglass kind of fill. And then the inner part, which is the connecting webbing of the spokes, is an elastomer-filled mixture with the polypropylene. And so the result is they have these two pieces, these two materials, but they're compatible in recycling. Now, you can't upcycle it, so to speak. You can only downcycle it and make other polypropylene things out of it that are less pure. But nevertheless, it's recyclable. And so that's an example of a tough trade-off, but it's progress. It's better than, turns out, what they did for the arms. The arms of those chairs, they really, really tried to make them out of polypropylene and make it fully recyclable, but they're not. It's a nylon over-molded with a thermoplastic elastomer, so they can separate it. In fact, you can take this entire chair apart 30 seconds, in less than 30 seconds per component, using standard tools. Like a hammer and a screwdriver and a pliers. So it's very disassemblable, which is great. I'll show you a little bit more about this chair. I mentioned Studio 7.5, which is in designers in Berlin, and this is just some of their design iterations and thinking about this chair. They actually approached Herman Miller with something pretty close to what's in the top left corner. Here's the concept of a simple integrated spine that will dramatically simplify the whole chair and make a new kind of multi-purpose chair. The results of this, for for this chair, actually, and so I've got some data here, and you'll see how this maps to how they assess DFE on the next slide. So the materials themselves, the materials they use, aluminum, polypropylene, steel, and all those are good materials to use because you can recycle each of them around and around that cycle. 44% of it is actually recycled material as opposed to virgin material. And so you can see that leaves lots of room for improvement, but it's still actually much better than they had been doing in the past. They've dematerialized it by 20 pounds by making it much lighter than a fully adjustable craft chair. It's very easy to disassemble. You see 86% easily separable, 92% recyclable, and so forth. And you see some data on the production line and so forth. When they ship this, there's no packaging. Basically, I actually ordered one, I got it in my office, and it came no packaging. And I saw them putting them out on trucks. They put a blanket over them, and out they go. So the packaging that they get from with the bases and materials from suppliers comes in returnable and reusable totes that I'm sure many of you are familiar with. So this represents a very kind of clean approach to making a product like this. I mentioned the surface treatment. So look at the base of this chair. The base is aluminum that's actually just bead blasted. There's no paint, there's no anodized, there's no coating on it, and so that makes it a fully recyclable aluminum base. When you do those coatings, it reduces the recyclability and the ability to use the material again in certain ways. So they played around with lots of different treatments of it, and so it turns out it's just a dull silver bead blasted surface finish, which is a pretty clever solution to that. Let me just finish up on Herman Miller by just showing you a bit about how they think about, they've actually developed a little spreadsheet tool to help them think about DFE assessment. And I've sort of deconstructed that in with this simple illustration. So what they do is they basically ask what fraction of all the materials by weight, so fraction of everything in the chair, in any product, by weight, is a safe material, is recycled, is from recycled material, is disassemblable, and is recyclable. And then it's a weighted fraction. So they weight it by, you know, one-third for material chemistry, one-third for disassembly, one-third for recycling, and that's split into, you know, recycled content, recyclability, as you see. And then basically they give those materials by weight a high fractional score if it's made of, so that look at materials chemistry, for example. If it's made of the safest possible material that has absolutely no environmental impact, they give it a green or 100% kind of credit. If it's made of something that has high hazards and makes, you know, toxics and so forth, they give it zero credit. And then they've got two in between. So this chair is made of all green and yellow, basically. So they have all, they have no materials that they've decided to ban entirely, like PVC. In using PVC, it creates toxins that create birth defects and poison the environment. So they said, look, we're just not going to use that. It may be recyclable, but we're not going to use that material because to produce it and use it and recycle it is hazardous. And so we're not going to use it. So that's an example of a red material, and then, you know, aluminum, steel, and so forth are green materials. In the recycled content, they get, for the moment, the way they're doing it, they get full credit if it's recycled material, post-consumer or post-industrial, and they get zero credit if it's a virgin material. And then they get credit for the component material by weight if it's fully disassemblable. That is, you can separate it from other non-compatible materials that are not compatible in recycling. You can do so in less than 30 seconds with common tools, and it's labeled as to what recycling stream it goes into by material. So you only get credit if it meets those requirements, and you don't get credit if it doesn't. And then recyclability, they get full credit if it can be upcycled. You know, you can take this aluminum base and make a new aluminum base out of it. You don't need to mix in or use virgin material. You get partial credit if it can only be downcycled, so it can be used for, you know, a lesser quality steel or plastic or whatever, and no credit if it's not feasible to recycle. So they've actually assessed every product component by component, material by material, according to these four dimensions, and they basically add them up. And that's how they think about every product every year. They want it to get better on this overall DSE scoring. So it's a pretty nice method that they've done. They had a bit of help from the Cradle to Cradle folks, the McDonough and Brongauer, who actually have a business to help companies do this. And so they actually, they did, for example, the green, yellow, orange, red categorization of 1,000 materials for Herman Miller. So that's a bit on Herman Miller. I actually think this is a pretty good approach that they've been thinking about. So I was pleased to be able to use that example in the chapter. Of course, they're not the only company that's doing this. A lot of designers, a lot of businesses think about this. Let me just show you one more simple example, totally separate from Herman Miller, and then we'll wrap up and take some questions. So this example comes from Puma, actually from a design firm called Fuse Project. So they created, just look at the packaging. Of course, we could talk about the shoes too, but let's just look at the packaging for the moment. So it's a cardboard box, and of course, cardboard is can use recycled paper, and it's fully recyclable, especially if you don't use toxic inks when you print on it. So this is a slightly smaller box, takes up less weight, less space. But also, then the outer bag is a reusable bag. Instead of having a plastic retail bag or a second box made with some shiny plasticky surface, the outer bag is made of recycled bottles, PET plastic, and is fully recyclable. So you could take that bag and recycle it as well. And one of the nice features is this. Just you get some advertising, you'll walk around the shopping mall or whatever with this, instead of putting it in an outer bag. So this is just another example of thinking about, okay, these are two materials. I've got the cardboard and I've got the plastic bag, and they're both fully recyclable, easily separable into two different waste streams. And they could go around and around those streams without creating toxins. So that's maybe an example of thinking about this and doing it. Admittedly, a pretty simple product, but getting it right. So I'd like to wrap up and just say, this isn't going to get fixed this year. This is a very, very hard but important thing to do. It's not appropriate to say, well, this is some other industry's problem because that industry is worse than my industry. It's not appropriate to say this is the government's problem because, they've just got to create laws and regulations and so forth. I think we all have to do this. Every business, even MIT has to think about this, all of your businesses, plus in our individual lives, because we're all making choices. And product designers in particular, your generation and new generation, the younger folks, I really believe if we train better to think this way, we'll start to have a bigger impact on making some improvements. It'll take generations to really get to sustainability, but if you believe, and I do, what the environmental activists are saying is that time's running out, we've got to start making progress a lot faster. So I hope this has given you some ways to think about starting to make progress a little bit faster. So I want to thank everybody, 76 of us, for attending today. If I can take some questions for a few minutes. Ignoring the questions you can send
me. No, that's fine. So Sergey is the first one, and then I think you can start going down.
Scroll back to see where we are. Sergey, what effect did the low environmental impact practices have on cost and production? That's interesting. I don't have the cost data, but there are actually some papers that talk a little bit about that. So at Herman Miller, you think about it, trucking away all that waste is expensive. And landfilling it, so composting it in the backyard and making electricity out of it is actually a pretty good deal. So they said, it's not easy to get started on it, or it's not easy to make as much progress as they have, but in the end, they got a much better workplace. They have a workplace without toxics, they got a workplace with more natural light, at a workplace with, you know, hardly any electricity needed to run that production line. There's a lot of gravity feed and stuff like that. So they've saved tons of money by doing it. Now, that's not to say that there are not examples of bad VFE decisions, right? So there are, you can think of examples of, well, boy, if I make it this way, it'll have less environmental impact, but it'll cost more. Okay, fine. There are examples of that. So that's an example of bad VFE. Just as, you know, there are examples of bad design for manufacturing that made bad product quality as a result of reducing costs, right? And so on the whole, when you get this right, it lowers costs. Good point about how many recycled bags. So there was, Phil asked the question of, you know, you gotta get all these recycled bags and use them for shopping and so on. You don't need too many of them. Well, okay, but we do need them. And, if they're recyclable, you know, that's not as big a deal, right? So if I could just take that recycled bag and recycle it again, okay, maybe I can reuse it, and maybe I don't need to, but at least I can recycle it. And that's better than having one that I couldn't recycle. So how about more complex products like automobiles, airplanes, other kinds of things? Well, yes, it's going to be more complex, but I think there's still huge opportunities. So let me just make a comment on automobiles. If I can make an automobile that lasts 20 years, but I couldn't recycle, or I can make an automobile that lasts 5 or 10 years, but when I'm done with it, I can, I don't know, dip it in a bath of something that just disassembles it into 100 different components that can be individually recycled. That'll have less environmental impact, right? So maybe I'd have to, you know, think about its durability as a trade-off and so on, but I think it's possible. So we're not going to get there very easily, but you think about carbon fiber is not a recyclable material. It just isn't recyclable at all. You know, you're just going to have to landfill it and wait a million years. So maybe we ought to think about using more aluminum and steel and other plastics, but what we would call monstrous hybrids are probably less appropriate. And so that's how you think about this for something highly complex. The question from Michael about, well, I skipped the question, hold on.
Brian Lim was next, I think.
Oh, yeah, a bunch here. Cost of implementing DFE versus marketing value add. I don't have data on that. Herman Mill, I talked to Herman Mill a little bit about that. They said, you know what, we don't really market this too strongly as this is a DFE product and that's why you should buy it. They could. They don't actually believe they're going to get a lot of market out of that. With the exception of people trying to install green buildings and get, you know, LEED certifications, and what they find, the way LEED, it's kind of silly, but the way LEED certification works is you get points for doing certain things, and you get points for having, you know, DFE-designed furniture, for example. So this could help you achieve a LEED certification. And so they get a bit of sort of marketing or sales out of that. But I don't see them as trumpeting this too loudly. I see them, they're doing this because it's good for the world, and, you know, it's more profitable because they're lowering costs by doing it. Okay. Economic trade-offs with green design. So Rick Nardo's question. Yeah. And is there a turning point? So the way I see this is there are good and bad decisions you can make in DFE. So you can make decisions to reduce environmental impact. They're going to cost more money, and it'll be not economically viable. Or you can make decisions on DFE where it doesn't. So, for example, in the Set-2 chair, right? So I talked about the arms. You know, they really, really tried to make the arms out of a recyclable material, and they just couldn't. I mean, they couldn't yet, or they couldn't without having too much cost, or they couldn't without having performance problems when you stand up and push on the arms or something. But maybe they will eventually. And so they tried to avoid the bad DFE decisions by saying, oh, what the hell, we'll make it recyclable anyway, even though it's going to cost more or fall apart. So they wouldn't do that, and that's why it's not fully recyclable. So they'll get there eventually, we hope. I think they made 100 of the good decisions, and they didn't make 100 of the bad decisions. And so that's the way I see it. It's not that there are trade-offs, well, there are trade-offs, but the key thing is you could make those decisions in a good or a bad way. James Brooks, how do they communicate the chair is disassemblable and recyclable years from now? The janitor needs to know, right? So that's an important effort. So first of all, when you look at this, you could look at it and say, oh, I'm done with that chair, I'm going to throw it out. And that would obviously be a problem. So we have a take-back problem here in the United States. We have a throwaway attitude, and we have a problem of getting people to recycle and take back more. But we're going to get there. So how do they communicate? So you make the fasteners a bit more obvious and a little bit less hidden. You make them easily separable instead of really difficult to do. And you label everything. So that's how they communicate it now. Maybe that could be done better, you know, in the future. In that Nike bag, is it obvious that you would separate those two and recycle the both rather than throwing the whole thing in the trash? Yeah, I don't know. Maybe it's not obvious enough, but we have to start thinking about that. So that's going to take some more time. Michael Short's question is, the red, yellow, green classification of materials done for Herman Miller available, assume not. Actually, this isn't highly sensitive because I heard it in a public seminar, but it will be announced, I believe, next week by the governor of California that there's going to be a new foundation created by McDonough and Brongard. And they're actually going to release it. So they're going to release their database. I don't know exactly how and what form and how usable, but the idea is that this is a really important public good that they can do. So you can't get Herman Miller's version of it and the ones that McDonough Brongart made for Nike and Herman Miller and other companies, but there is going to be very soon a public version of it. I'm looking forward to that, and I'm going to see what that looks like pretty soon. So what I'm hoping is there'll be 5,000 materials in there growing to 100,000 or whatever, so it'll probably still be too complex, but I'm hoping it'll be quite usable, so you'll at least be able to see not just green, yellow, red, but, you know, what are all the environmental impacts. And then I think what it would take is for a business to say, okay, our PD process starts with a selection of materials. These are the green ones, the yellow ones, the red ones, and so forth. And maybe they come from that database. So you take the thousands, and then you say, all right, these are the 200 materials we can't use that are currently in our usage, and these are 50 we will use, and we'd like to use them exclusively and use them more over time. So that's coming pretty soon, is the answer. Adam Wolf question. Seems that reducing impact in one area usually increases impact in another area in more complex products. Well, there are certainly examples of that. I don't know if it usually does, but maybe it's true that it usually does because we're not thinking about this quite as carefully. There certainly are counterexamples that you can come up with that suggest, you know, that this is futile. And hybrid cars is a good example that you suggested. Sure, you could have a hybrid car that reduces the impact of use, which is the biggest impact of an automobile is the fuel and the environmental impact of the fuel consumption. So it's good that we're reducing that, but you're creating, in some case, a really bad hazardous waste problem with the batteries that are not reusable, recyclable, or at least yet. And so there's been some criticism of the hybrids for that reason, and maybe I think that's perhaps slowed the adoption or the development of electric vehicles. But I actually believe in the future we're going to solve that problem too. So we're going to have batteries that are made of different materials. We're going to have batteries that are swappable, batteries that when you're done using them, they're less efficient, so you don't want to carry them and use them, but they're still usable for other things, such as smoothing out the electricity demand on the grid and things like that. So we got to solve that problem. You're right. So hopefully we'll get there. We'll make a bit of progress every year, and maybe not in my lifetime, but over a period of time, we're going to get there. Let's see.
Teresa is next.
Oh, there we go. How do you incorporate into a business case? Well, so I'm not quite sure why you think the process increases costs, unless you think it's that, you know, DFE takes more time in development and therefore increases costs or slows their development time or both. So that's certainly a concern. And I think that concern is a typical worse before better concern. You know, sure, when we try this new thing, it's going to take us more time in development, and it's going to get worse. That is, it's going to take us more time, it's going to have more confusion, we're going to make mistakes, but we're going to learn, and we'll eventually have a better process, and we will be better eventually. So I think it's a typical improvement process that will experience a worse before better dynamic. So, okay, so maybe the development process will get slower and more complex and more tedious or whatever because you have to have new chemists or materials people and new databases and new steps. But we'll get better at doing that. So I think that's the worse before better problem that's in a business case. Next question from Michael. Great news on a database lines up with some elements of reach. So I don't know what those things are, but... So I can't answer on the alignment, but I'd say let's stay tuned because I heard William McDonough actually came to MIT, I guess it was just last week, for Earth Day. He gave an Earth Day lecture, and so I was pleased to be able to meet him, and he mentioned this, not privately to me, but in the seminar. So he said, you know, he's not ready to announce it. He wants the governor of California to announce it next week, so he's not going to... say anything in detail about it, but he said it's coming out, so stay tuned.
Okay, any other questions?
Zip through them all.
If you want to, yeah, I think we've gotten them through them all.
Well, thank you everyone for participating, and I'm sure some people will send me comments. I look forward to that.
Great, thanks Steve so much. Really appreciate your taking the time to share this research with us. Everybody, Richard DeNufko was supposed to be up next Friday. Unfortunately, he has to postpone. His presentation will be in July. The next presentation will be in early June. More information will be going out about that shortly. Thanks a lot again, everyone.